Talking fishing, talking fishing, nothing but fishing, talking fishing. If it's facts about fishing that you want to know, then tune in, folks, because this is the show. We'll show you all the right bait to use, so sit right back, you got nothing to lose. Doesn't really matter if it's trout or carp, flathead, marlin, or a gummy shark. Listen to the guys and you can't go wrong. They'll be talking about fishing till the cows come home. Talking fishing, talking fishing, nothing but fishing, we're talking fishing.
Welcome everyone to Talking Fishing, a big show coming your way tonight, including pictures of a metre plus Murray cod coming out of Lake Eildon last weekend. Quite a commotion on Altona Pier. We take a look at what caused that. A fish thief got caught stuffing calamari down his waders. What an idiot. And we're joined by the event director of this weekend's 4x4 and Fishing Expo at the Melbourne Showgrounds. All that and more, let's get into it with a big welcome to the man who travels by kayak, Adam Ring. Welcome, Ads.
Thanks, Dave. It's time to dust off the kayak, finally. It's been a few nice weekends have rolled on and off we go.
Did I mention it's going to hail this weekend?
Starting the weekend.
It doesn't matter because you are taking your kayak to the 4x4 show this weekend.
In fact,
you're going to take the whole collection and everyone will be able to see the kayaks.
Come and have a look.
We're going to talk about kayak fishing because it's a growing sport, isn't it?
It is. It's a great way to get around.
It's a big welcome back to the man who made it out of Africa alive. His first show back from a winter break all the way from Shepparton. Welcome, Stephen Victor Trelly Trelfel.
Thanks for that, David.
No worries, Trelly. Anytime.
No worries.
You made it back, mate.
I did, actually. Some amazing things happened over there and some great stories to be told, but one of the biggest stories was the actual poaching that goes on over there.
Okay.
Now, we know poaching is poaching, but these guys are in gangs with AK-47s and things, so yeah, it's a pretty sad story.
So what are they poaching?
A lot of rhinoceroses for their horn, their front horn.
Still?
Yeah,
in
still.
In this day and age?
And close to town, like within kilometres of the main, you know, like Johannesburg.
So what, there's big money in it or something, obviously,
huge
is there?
Money. Yeah. Huge money. So, yeah, that's one of the sad stories over there. But a lot of good stuff we got up to, too, on the train, which is great.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Okay, plenty of stories to be told tonight, I tell you what. And it's just a little sprinkling of spring almost, isn't there, in the air? You know, it's been fairly good weather, bit of warm weather even on the weekend. I know it was a little bit blowy, but Sunday was okay, and some nice fish caught too.
Yeah, it's been good because obviously it's been a long winter and a lot of people have stayed in hibernation, and I don't blame them. It has been cold and it's been wet, but all that seems to be a little bit behind us. It felt different. 18 degrees doesn't sound warm, but you know that sun's got a little bit of bite, and it's so interesting to see the motivation that sort of runs through your body once there's a bit of warmth going on. So looking forward to summer.
Yeah. Spring is only around the corner now. Trelly, we asked you for a photo or two, and this is the only one you came up with. No, this is a serious photo.
Yeah, okay.
Now, my eyes are playing up on me a little bit tonight, but I can't work out what sort of animal that is. But so you put that on the roast. Did this crackling go hard on that at all?
Well, never seen one rotisserised.
I am joking. We do not promote harming. That's a baby rhinoceros.
That is, yeah. Well, that was one of the byproducts of the poaching, that one. So that was actually in an area that's basically a rehabilitation for animals.
Okay.
And that little guy there, you noticed, actually had its horn cut off as well.
Yeah.
But it was cute. It was like, you know, you could see it was only so big.
Yeah.
You know, it'd come up to you and sort of like get along the fence and you could pat him and do all that sort of stuff. And, you know, give him a poke. But, geez, thick skin. They just like poking that table. But,
really?
Yeah.
Now, Trelly, it wouldn't be the same if we didn't happen to come across a picture of you in your travels. Have a look what you got up to, Trelly. You always get caught out lying on the lounge after a few drinks, and you just got transported around South Africa like that. Is that right?
Well, I did actually, and I just wanted to keep the South African culture going.
Yeah.
Just being carted around there.
I tell you what.
From shooting stand to shooting stand.
Yeah, just having a little break in between shots. But anyway, boys, let's have a look at what's been caught by the people at home. It's time for Catch of the Week.
Catch of the Week, brought to you by Shimano, providing reliable, trustworthy, quality fishing gear for your enjoyment.
Now, our first Catch of the Week gets an 11 out of 10 for effort because Paul Delisle, he's been heading up to Eildon for quite some time now, and he's had many a session on a 60 and 70 centimetre fish, but have a look at that. Cracked the metre for the first time, 105 centimetres on a stump jumper in the Big River Arm. Thank you very much.
Nice fish. Look at that. It's a great... look at it, proportion of that fish is just perfect, isn't it?
It's perfect, isn't it? Yeah.
Really
yeah.
nice fish.
Paul was absolutely stoked, released unharmed. You know, he said it seriously, it was out of the water for about 10 seconds. I spoke to him today about it, and he just said, you know, fish of a lifetime.
Yep.
He has certainly put in the hours. But, Charlie, we had Anthony Forster filling in for you last week, and he said, you know, even though it will be closed season very shortly in everywhere else in Victoria, Lake Eden will remain open, and it's probably the time for the big ones.
It is. It is. That's right. And it's becoming a little bit more common, some of these big fish, and it will do that for a long time to come as well. They'll just keep getting bigger.
Yeah. Let's stick with the freshwater flavour and a lovely little reservoir on the Mornington Peninsula. It's called Devil Bend, and if you want to head down there now, the water's cold, the air temperature's cold, the days are cold, and that's the typical brown trout coming out of Devil Bend. Have a look at that.
And the quality of these browns, that's a good quality brown trout as you'll ever want.
Well, there's so much food. It's a healthy waterway. And Shane, well done. Congratulations, because that's a cracker fish in anyone's books, I reckon. So.
And the land-based resi, so take the kids down there and throw those tassies.
Exactly. Have a barbie while you're down there and all that. So let's head over the other side of the Mornington Peninsula to Flinders Pier, the old capital of calamari land-based. Yep. And Caleb Eagle sent in this photo. There's a nice little model there off the Flinders Pier. Great place to fish out of the northerlies too.
Yeah, that's right. And it's it seems to be one of those places that can be a little bit hit or miss. But we're definitely in the hit stages of the last week, and there's been some big models cruising around too. We're starting to get into that spawning season for the big calamari, so keep an eye out for that.
Just a little bit inside of Western Port is Stony Point, and Fady Elmarazzi, I think that's how you say it. He got this one that went in a beautiful snapper, 10.4 kgs. That's a nice fish.
Just a lazy 10 kilo fish. Yeah. Have one of that. It's a cracker.
That is a nice, solid fish. So every week now, we've got first 3 weeks of the show back, Charlie, some really nice winter snapper. You know, and they're not, everyone's not getting them. Few and far between, but those anglers that put the hours in,
big,
certainly getting some nice big fish at the moment. So Adam Lewis wrote into us, and I've got a little bit about his email here. It just said, he resides in King Lake West, and he was admitted to hospital 2 weeks ago after hitting a big red kangaroo on his way home on his Honda CBR 1000. He just picked it up 2 days prior because he'd hit a wombat. Not so long before that. So he's in that picture there. Two nice gummy sharks, one broken leg, two broken arms, two fractured ribs. Well done. Adam got out of hospital for the weekend with his mate. He's back in now, just a bit of rehab, but a couple of nice gummies. Lazy weekend.
Just a tip, Ads. Stop hitting the wildlife with your bike.
Yeah.
Kangaroo come off.
Stick to fishing. I tell you what. Let's head up to the Tambo River now, and Josh Penzer was up there fishing with his dad. Normally on the brim,
but
they were surprised to get a lovely estuary perch while up the Tambo.
One of the best fish you'll ever catch in an estuary.
Yeah. Saltfish,
they are so good.
Yeah. I mean, estuary perch are stocked in some places, like Devil Bend we were just talking about, but to get one out of there, you know, potentially wild fish in the Tambo River is pretty special.
Oh, definitely. And I think they're going to have to go through a name change soon, because we commonly refer to them as the Barra of the South. Yeah. Well, we've actually got Barra in the South now, so they're going to have to find something else.
There you go. If you'd like to send in a pic of your catch of the week, this is what you have to do.
If you want to be like me and have your photo on TV, email your fishing pic to info@ifish.com.au.
We were just talking about the estuary perch before we go to a break. I know a few of the boys started heading down to Devil Bend to try and have a fly fish for them, and I was just saying to the boys, what you need really, the great ingredient this time of year is around about a full moon, which I think we've got in the next couple of days. Mm-hmm. Get down there right on dusk, little bit of glitter in your fly, and just cast out to the weeds, not too far offshore, and that's the recipe for some great estuary perch down at Devil Bend.
So. Yeah, and you'll be surprised at Devil Bend. Everything else from the redfin to the big trout, we're just seeing on the edge of those weed beds. You know, we make the mistake of going and trying to cast into the middle of the resi where the fish necessarily aren't. So stick close to the weeds and those perch are going to fire up as we get into spring.
Top water
Fly fishing. Yeah.
Fly fishing.
Yeah.
It's still a little bit early. It's still a little bit early.
But if you're going to try it, get on the moon phase, on the full moon, where everything's well lit at night and right on dusk. It's just perfect for those fish, Trelly. Yep. So. Coming up on Talking Fishing, Product of the Week, and we preview this weekend's 4x4 and Fishing Expo with event director Paul Mathers right after this.
Talking Fishing.
We know what you'd rather be doing.
We know what you've really got in mind.
We know you'd rather be out fishing. And today
day's the day you're gonna wear the line.
'Cause every day's a good day. Stop wishing. Every day's a chance to drift away.
Drift away.
Every day's a good day for fishing. See you down at Tackle World today.
Product of the week, brought to you by Tackle World.
Talking fishing.
It's that time of year when there's a lot of species biting or starting to bite, and ads, there's a whole lot of gear that you just need to have right now, isn't there?
Yeah, there is. I know we've probably talked a lot about how tough the winter's been, but the facts are there has been some good fishing to be had, and we've probably found it's been a season where a few new items, or maybe some items that have been on the market for quite some time, have just found their place. And I'll start straight away with the tuna season, because that's what we're in at the moment, and that's been the big thing that's firing. Bonds lures are something that have been around for a long time, but have only just made their way to our market here in Victoria. I've got two sorts here, the Bonds D-Shackle and Bonds The Heat. Now, these have worked everywhere from Port McDonald on the Big Tuna, Portland for the Big Tuna, Bermagui, Scotty Harper, who we work with at Tackle Cranbourne. He got among some big fish on these very recently. And I know the boys in South Australia absolutely love them as well. So keep an eye out for them. They're something that are new to our shores here in Australia, but have been around for quite some time, developed and made in New Zealand. These are going to be big. I can guarantee it. Next season, the word's going to get out. It's been a little bit of a household best kept secret, but they will be out there and all amongst it next weekend. And Dave, Scotty swears by these things.
Yeah, handmade in New Zealand.
They are. And the colours are just spectacular. It's hard to sort of see on the TV there, but just insane. They're all UV heads, shine the UV light.
And those people that do use them swear by them, don't they?
They do,
I know,
yeah.
Scotty's a big champion of them, but you can't find them in all tackle shops, but those that do have them, it's a great range, great selection,
exactly.
And just absolute tuna machines.
Yep, a premium lure and worth every cent. We can't talk about fishing in winter and not talk about squid. There's a few jigs here which colour-wise seem to be dominating sales at the moment. We've got the Hayabusa in the green. I know a few of the charter boat operators around have been using these with great success, especially in the southern part of Port Phillip Bay. I don't know what it is down there. The weed beds get thick. Maybe there's a lot of grass whiting around, but the green really seems to get it done. And there's a couple of colours in the Click Squid jigs, which have been around for quite a long time, but are really starting to dominate and take over some of those sales of the whites and reds that we talk about all the time. There's a green one here with a red belly. And Dave, I'll get to you in a minute because I know this is your favourite squid jig of all time. Yeah. But there's another one that's come out, which is I wish I could tell you what colour it was, but it is actually a mixture of three different colours. Depending on which way you look at it, it's a see-through red. If you look at it from one way, it goes green. If you look at the other way, it goes blue. So it's a very unique colour. And land based off the rocks around the Mornington Peninsula, this is really starting to dominate. But Dave,
Can I have a look at that one? Because I was seeing glimpses of blue as you were showing me.
That's right. Depending on which way you look at it.
That is just sensational.
Yeah, again, very hard to try and describe over the TV.
It actually looks different from the front as it does the back.
That's right.
So it's blue from the back, green from the front. That's amazing.
And land based on the peninsula, that's been big time. And Dave, we can't go past the green. I know you love
it. That is my favourite.
Another thing that's happened, salmon have come in massive, massive numbers into Port Phillip Bay, and a lot of the guys are catching them off the piers. I guess the normal metal slug's been around forever and a day, but these little ones by Hayabusa, called a jackeye, are absolutely sensational. Let them sink and they get a nice flutter. You can work them slow for a nice wide darting action, or just wind the hell out of them if those salmon are really on. But keep an eye out for them. Some beautiful colours. They're starting to use the UV paint. That's starting to move its way through the metal lure range. So keep an eye out for them. They're a ripper. Now, Trelly, we're talking Eildon cod.
Yep.
I've got three lures here. The Storm Arashi, the Old Mate, which I know you had a very, very big hand in producing, and obviously the Stump Jumper, which we saw Paulie D catch his big cod on.
Yeah.
These three lures in the three colours you see on your screen right now have taken big, big Murray cod in the last month. So write that down. There's a purple there, there's a pink, and then there's this really funky blue chartreuse colour, which is a little bit different, but write them down. They're big time. And Trelly, I know Old Mates have been getting it done in your neck of the woods for a long time, and it's starting to make its way down to
all
us.
All working well.
And the Paterson River. excuse me while I reach over and grab these little beauties. They have. It's probably fished the best it's fished in a long time, and these are really hard to see because they're very small, but the old cranker crab. We've had them on the show before. They are really coming into their own. Those two colours you see on there are a couple of the new fiddler colours. You can work them in the deep water, you can work them in the shallow, but cast them up on a pontoon, a rock wall, or a boat hull. Work them really, really slow. That's the big key, and the bream have been diving all over them. So Dave, the cranker crab, it's still getting it done. A lot of the shops now have got plenty of stock, which has been a bit of an issue. So make sure you grab them before we all run out again.
Absolutely essential if you want to get into some of that bream fishing, and well done, Ads. Now, let's to change the subject. If you want to have a look at all the fishing gear, lots and lots of fishing gear, boats, the whole lot, get along to the Melbourne 4x4 Fishing and Boating Expo. It's on this Friday and Saturday. And if you'd like to get some cheap tickets, get on to 4x4show.com.au. Use the promo code IFISH and you'll get your tickets for $15. You can also buy them at Tackle World, at Cranbourne and Mornington if you want to get in early before the show. But it is going to be a cracker Friday, Saturday and Sunday at the Melbourne Showgrounds. And joining us now, Paul May, that's the event director. Paul, welcome again, because you were here last year.
G'day,
telling us
Dave.
About the event.
How is? Sounds like you're stealing promo codes from another TV program.
Maybe, yes. just a little shared promo code there. So,
fair enough.
Paul, big show lined up again this year. I know the feature, Paul Worsing, as always, he's there for the entire 3 days. But you've got old Starlo.
We've got Starlo back. Yeah. I don't think he's been to Melbourne 4x4 show for
many years.
Yeah, so he's come back. He was the star of our Brisbane show earlier this year, and he's coming back with his wife to talk a bit of fishing. You'll be there, I know.
We'll be there for 3 days.
Sharing your wisdom.
Same with Adam, sharing our wisdom and all sorts. So it's not only about fishing, very big 4x4 component as always. And
Are you doing
the same, monster trucks there at all?
Monster trucks, FMX bikes, rollover trucks, a comp truck. We got some really cool stuff going. So, if the kids come along, there's something to entertain them. Lots of noise and dirt being thrown up in the air, all that good fun stuff for them, as well as their playground area too, which we've got. Something for all the family. I mean, mums and dads won't necessarily... Well, some of them will be into the monster trucks, I suppose.
Yeah.
But, there's lots of education too. And if you're just starting out as a family and you want to get out on the tracks, or you want to just start camping and you don't really know how to go about it, or you bought a four-wheel drive, you don't really know how to use it, or even better, how to get out of trouble if you get into trouble, then this is a great place to come and learn all of those skills. And we've got a proving ground there where you can get in a car.
So you can actually jump in a car and drive around yourself.
Yeah, you can. With a trainer.
Yeah.
And the guys from 4 Drive Victoria are going to do a great job for us doing all of that education, all that teaching stuff. So if you get in a jam when you're out in the bush, you at least sort of know how to go about getting back into safety. And that's a really important lot of skills that you need before you can really even start. Skills is as simple as towing trailers. I'm terrible at towing a trailer. Jeez, I tell you what, I need a few lessons. But, they're the sorts of things that you can learn. Yeah. And they're really great skills to have.
Now, we have a fishing stage, obviously, where we're talking fishing all 3 days. And we've got Starlo, we've got fly casting demonstrations, Marine Safety Victoria, myself, Paul, lots of information up on the stage. We're talking kayaks, we're talking how to use your sounders and GPSs. But it's not the only stage of the show, is it? You've got a couple of other stages?
No, three big stages.
Three big stages.
So, yeah, we've grown. We've got the fishing stage, obviously, which is the Tackle World fishing stage. And you mentioned the fly fishing sessions, and they're great. There's so much skill that goes into fly fishing, but it's kind of a really zen thing to do, isn't it?
Yeah.
I tried it for the first time last year, and the guys from Yarra Valley Fly Fishing Association had a lot of patience, let me tell you, because I was throwing that thing, I was plopping down here. But I learned some skills there. That was very cool. So, yes, we've got that sort of stuff going on for the fishing. For the four-wheel drive enthusiasts, there's a lot about them, and all of the stars of their favourite four-wheel drive and off-road adventure shows, they're all there. People like Ruth and Jace Andrews and Rick O'Brien and Jamie from the Off-Road Adventure Show and Shauna and Graham from the Four-Wheel Drive Action video series, and a whole bunch of others. They're all there sharing the stories of their adventures, and they're always a bit of a cack, you know.
Now that's the 4x4 stage.
That's the Waco Outback stage. And then, of course, we've got the cooking stage, which is sponsored by the Anglers and Spider Everett.
Yep.
And we've got Ben Milbourne on there talking about, he was a MasterChef contestant, I think. I don't know if I can say MasterChef.
Doesn't matter.
he was a contestant on another program. He's going to be teaching. There's a bunch of other guys that are there on the stage along with Spider, teaching you how to make some great gourmet meals when you're out in the bush.
Adam, you would know Ken the Chef. Let's call him Ken the Chef.
Is he going to be there, is he?
Ken the Chef is on the cooking stage this year.
It's legit.
I tell you what, there's a man that can cook up a storm. He comes to our trout demonstration every year, and he does a different recipe with trout every year, and he is just amazing.
And he also comes to a couple of our Christmas parties and cooks up a feast with the boys.
Awesome.
And Peter Hookey from the Australian Seafood Show will be there as well.
So that's right.
Cooking up a storm. So you've got some great chefs, and of course Spider Everett, if you want to come and have your yarn to Spider he's there for the whole show.
He's a top bloke. He's there on Friday and Saturday. I think he's got to go and do his AFL calling duties.
Yep.
But he'll be there with his wife, Cherie, from the Great Australian Doorstep. They're a top couple, those two, and they do a great job on that stage. It'll be lots of fun, that's for sure.
Plenty of things to buy as well, so there's a big retail component to the show as well, isn't there?
Dave, it's all about buying. Yeah. You know, at the end of the day, we've got some 200 exhibitors there. Yeah. They've got specials. I know people come to these shows and they want to get something for nothing, you know. I'm going to throw out the challenge. You got to ask for the discount. Don't just expect it to be there for you. Ask for it. I guarantee you, all of our exhibitors are there and they're waiting for people to ask them for that good deal.
Mm.
You know, they know that they've got specials in the shops and online and all of that sort of thing, but they come to these shows to meet the public en masse and do great deals.
Mm.
So if you don't ask, you'll never know.
The other thing is, I know, on the fishing stage alone, we are giving away $2,000 worth of gear over the 3 days. So it's a pretty big special thing. Get along to the Melbourne 4x4 Fishing and Boating Expo this Friday, 9 till 6, Saturday, 9 till 6, and Sunday, 9 till 5. I know it's going to hail on Friday and potentially Saturday. No, but
that's good to be endorsed.
Just highlighted all the things. $15 tickets, 4x4show.com.au. And we've just highlighted all the things. You can just sit there and watch stage shows. You can buy stuff. You can have a look at four-wheel drives, all that sort of stuff. It doesn't matter what the weather's doing. You won't be going out in your boat. You may as well come along to the show. Up next, fisheries news, including details about some idiot who thought it was a good idea to take too many calamari and hide them in his waders. Right after this on Talking Fishing.
Talking Fishing.
Good morning, spotters. Stephanie speaking.
Talking fishing, talking fishing, nothing but fishing, we're talking fishing.
Live from the studios of Channel 31 Melbourne, it's now time for some very fishy news.
A little bit of news just to keep people entertained this week, boys. I tell you what, let's kick it off with this one. Angler exceeds calamari catch limit at Port Arlington. A 69-year-old man from Port Arlington will be summoned to appear in the Geelong Magistrates Court later this year for allegedly exceeding the daily catch limit of calamari. Fisheries Victoria officer Brad Smith said the man was observed over the course of a day by fisheries surveillance, allegedly undertaking what they call multi-trip activities, boys.
So I tell you what, and
it gets spoken about plenty of times. Your daily bag limit is your daily bag limit.
That's right.
You don't do a fishing trip and go home and then go out and do the same thing.
It's not a trip limit, it's a daily bag limit.
Exactly. Now, it was alleged that the man went fishing from the Grassy Point boat ramp in the morning, then again later the same day at Steele's Rock boat ramp. So he went to two different boat ramps, ending up with a total catch of 25 calamari on one day. So even his single bag limit of 10 was exceeded, obviously, along there.
Yep.
After the second trip, he was allegedly observed wrapping calamari in plastic bags and concealing them in the leg of his waders.
Oh.
What an idiot. Who would walk around with waders full of calamari?
It makes it so much funnier that they're actually watching him do it.
Could you imagine being a fisheries officer watching someone wrapping calamari in plastic bags?
How would you be? You'd
and
be sitting
stuffing
there.
Them down your waders. This. Yeah. I know. Anyway, when he was approached by officers, he produced just 10 calamari and claimed they were his total catch for the day. After a search, the man was allegedly found to have taken 25 calamari over the two fishing trips and also found to have undersized snapper in a freezer at his home. So they obviously took him home and had a good look as well. Yeah. So didn't just look at his waders. There you go. So he's in a bit of trouble. Mm. The man had all the calamari, the undersized snapper, his fishing equipment and his boat seized and will face a number of charges when he faces court. So there you go. The fact of the matter is, and we've said it plenty of times on the show, that if you're going to conceal your catch, you're going to hide it, you're going to lose your boat, you're going to lose all your gear, because it's the act of hiding, concealing, that you're just showing that you're doing the wrong thing.
Well, it's got dodgy written all over it once you start doing that.
Or you make sure you do it properly.
All right, let's keep going with fisheries news. The next one, there was a little truck that just backed up to the edge of a lake down at Hazelwood Pond. Is there, and have a look at that tank there. Is absolutely chock-a-block full of barramundi. Thank you very much. So the 5,000 barramundi have been going in over the past few days. Seven truckloads, to be precise.
Wow.
And those 5,000 barra are now in Hazelwood Pond.
They look
thank
a decent
much.
Size, so too. Those
all 30 centimetres.
All 30, yeah.
Yeah, they're all the one size.
No, and they're bigger than us, yeah.
You know, good so size. They're they're a great size. They will grow. Now we had a barramundi reference group meeting last week, and those fish that were released in April at 30 centimetres are now up well over the 50, getting on 60 centimetres. So absolutely great growth rates.
That's
You know, it's just a healthy fishery, and some of those fish have been sampled now as far as their flesh quality and all that sort of stuff. We're just waiting on results of that. So as soon as that comes to hand, we'll talk about it on Talking Fishing. But they are doing all those sort of tests right now as we speak. Now, Charlie, I'm going to start a new segment.
Yes.
This one's part of fisheries news, but I'm going to call it "I Want Your Honest Opinion, Charlie." All right. So get that. Whenever I say "I Want Your Honest Opinion, Charlie," what I want from you
is... I thought
is,
this was going to be a quiet segment.
No. First, I've been waiting for you to come back, I tell you. So, when I say, I want your honest opinion, Trelly, what I want is the most politically incorrect answer that you can give us, all right?
But
just be yourself.
Craig, get on the button.
But we still want to show next week, so just be careful.
Yeah. So don't do anything illegal or anything that's going to get...
No.
But, Trelly, so at Altona Pier on the weekend...
Yeah.
This is what happened, and we can talk while the footage is rolling, but this is what happened at Altona Pier. Now, many people could say that there was a massive run of snapper because of the big blow, but it's not blowing, or a great run of garfish have been spotted off the Altona Pier, and look at everyone.
Yep.
The fact is it had nothing to do with fishing, right? See everyone there? They've all got their phones in their hand.
Yeah.
There's a Pokemon, apparently, on the end of the pier. Can you... Yeah. This is Altona Pier. Is that... Trelly, I'd like your honest opinion. What do you think?
I thought they were all going out there to, you know, say goodbye to a heap of refugees leaving off the boat at the end. I don't know.
I'll tell you where
have
they
you seen anything like this so ridiculous?
Push them off the Tasmanian.
I'll tell you where they should put the Pokemon. And it's not on the end of the pier.
But how's that guy ran into a fence the other day, too? Pokemon. It's going to be accidents, isn't it?
All those people going along, how ridiculous is that? They're going into on Altona Pier. To find... Well, I don't even know what a Pokemon is. What is it?
If there's only one Pokemon, how come just they all go out there? Does he get got?
No idea. I don't know. Don't look at me.
I don't know. Why... Yeah. Whoever invents Pokemon, why couldn't they put it like 30 foot off the end?
That's what I'm saying.
Why didn't they walk off the end?
It should be off the end, not on the end of the pier.
Now, in all honesty, do you know what a Pokemon is?
My kids did have Pokemon, so those little things, but toys and things, but yeah, not really, no.
Have you got?
They didn't collect the cards.
Have you got the game or the app on your phone?
No, definitely not.
No.
That's just a waste of time.
There's a lot of people doing it, though.
Oh,
seriously.
There's more people doing that than fishing, obviously.
That is just ridiculous, anyway. Yeah. Charlie, give us another highlight of your trip in Africa. What did you get up to?
One of the highlights was my wife, Mary, actually loaded in 5 hours over 1,000 rounds of ammunition in my firearm.
Serious?
I was shooting, yep. Was just
you have a lovely
poetry in motion. Right. It was just Mary was there, and she, as I was breaking the gun open, I didn't even look. She just popped two more shells in. I jammed her fingers a couple of times, and popped a couple in her head on the ejection.
The shells, not the not sort of.
No. As they come out, they eject. Put a couple in a meal, a cup of tea,
dear.
And a glass of Chardonnay.
Oh, so, yeah. Dear, I tell you what, he's got a couple of stories still to come up. Don't forget, you can keep up to date with all the info from tonight on our Facebook page with Catch of the Week hotspots and much more. Don't forget to like our page. If you know someone who you think would like to watch the show, tell them we now stream live on the internet. And you can also watch a repeat of our show each Thursday and Saturday mornings right here on C31. Just check the program guide for more details. And every episode is posted to our YouTube channel. You'll find the correct links to Facebook, YouTube, and live streaming on our website, talkingfishing.com.au. Did you shoot anything that you ate, Trilly?
Yeah, pretty much everything we shot, we actually ate. Yeah. Not the whole lot of it, but we had a sample of all sorts of things. But it was really good. Like, as they drive things, drive the birds to you, you get all sorts of critters running at you like these.
What do you mean they drive the birds to you?
Well, you get all these locals, and they drive the birds to you. They get in the bush and they make noise and jump up and down.
When they all fly towards you and you shoot them.
Yeah, and they shoot right in. But there's the warthogs that run past you, and there's little antelope and big kudus and
cool
things and stuff come at you and all sorts of stuff, yeah.
There you go. Yeah. Up next, Kramer's Mailbag and plenty more on Talking Fishing.
Talking Fishing.
G'day, David Kramer here. I'm a massive fan of the Mazda BT50, having personally driven and owned one for more than 5 years now. And to tell you what, you can't beat it for an all-round great ute and a great tow vehicle. Get into Mornington Mazda before the end of the month and grab yourself a run-out bargain. Plus, with every BT50, you get all this $500 worth of fishing gear for free. I made mine a Mornington Mazda.
Make mine a Mornington Mazda.
Talking fishing, nothing but fishing, we're talking fishing.
Little bit of mailbag this week, boys. A couple of good questions amongst them too, so you might need to help me out with some of this stuff. First one is from Trent Underwood, and he writes, "Hey fellas, firstly I'd like to say a big thank you for the show and all the generous information knowledge that is shared by all the pros and industry experts on Talking Fishing. The show is a wealth of info and it's refreshing to have a fishing news show, not just a watch me catch show." There you go. Now, quick question. I found the more people ask, the longer the answer and the options seem to get. I'm setting up my first big game setup, and my question is about fully rollered rods versus just a roller tip. Ads, take note. I'll let you answer this one. I'd like it to be as versatile as possible. I'll be targeting big sharks, paddling baits out off beach at 90 Mile, down at 90 Mile Beach, to kingfish and sharks out of a boat, and possibly tuna in seasons to come. I'll be running 50-pound braid topped with 100 metres of mono braid simply for line capacity. I've been told that heat friction can be an issue with regular guides, and then I've been told that this was more so with older guides and not a real issue anymore, from braid slipping in between rollers and maintenance issues. I'm just not sure what the real issues are and the way to go. I'm looking at the Shimano Backbone Elite 24 kilo rod. Please help, as it's giving me a headache for the last week. Do I really need to go fully roller these days? I feel as if they can go wrong a lot quicker than regular guides, and they will have me back in the tackle shop spending my money on replacements before I lose a fish. Ads, what do you reckon?
Trent, great question.
Yeah.
And I'll make it as simple as I physically can. Because you're going to be using the rod off a beach, stay away from fully rollered rods, because everything you've heard about sand and grit and grime getting in amongst the rollers and leading to corrosion is 100% true. Guides, don't worry about guides. This day and age, they are all built to handle braid. The days of the soft O-ring guide are gone. So don't stress about that. You won't have a problem at all. I would be going with a straight roller tip. We've got some good friends of ours in both Sail and Morwell who helped us design some land-based game rods for them for their beach fishing, and they stayed away from rollers altogether. They've actually got a runner tip, not a roller tip, pure and simply for that reason. So if I was you, Trent, I would be sticking to roller tip. I would go into a lot more detail, but we haven't got time, so please come and see us at the 4x4 show on the weekend, Or after that, give us a call at Tackle World Warnings and I'll be there and I'll be more than happy to give you as much information as you need.
There you go. Well done, Ads. Yeah. Next one. Hey, Kramer. This is from Brian Henderson up at Maroombula. Hey, Kramer, when do you reckon the governments are going to get together and have one licence from Victoria and New South Wales? Make it the same as a car and a boat licence. You only need one. Well, Brian, I heard that was a question, and thank you to everyone who came along to the Port Phillip Bay conference last Friday night. It was a great crowd there, and this question actually came up there, boys, that what's happening? So the Victorian and the New South Wales governments have got together. Now, the problem is neither one wants to lose the revenue for their own licence. So what they've come up with is one licence. It's going to cost the combination of both licences. So if it's, I don't know what the price of a New South Wales one is now.
It's
but
pretty similar to ours, isn't it?
$65.
No, for a year.
For 1 year?
Oh, no.
And it'd be better. Say it's $35.
$35 or something?
Yeah, what is it, $35
for
now
us,
in Victoria?
Yeah,
so, it's going to be $70 a year, but you just get one licence. You just carry around one licence. So I know it's not what everyone expected, but it's the best because you're just not getting the two parties coming together. And, of course, in Queensland, South Australia, you don't need a licence. So
Or we have a revolution.
Or we could have that.
Between the two states.
Yeah.
Get them together.
We could. A couple more. This is off the Facebook page, boys, that we had quite a few questions this week. Ant McLaughlin, he asked, what methods are being used at Casey Fields for rainbow trout, please? Ads?
Methods. Fishing close to the weed. We mentioned it at Devil Bend. Same rules apply. Under a float, little bit of power bait. Gold.
Very good. Andrew Carroll writes, hi there. The name is Andrew. Just wondering what these fish conferences, cod, trout, etc. Is there any chance you guys can film them and put on DVD, as not all fishos can get to those nights due to work commitments or other? Also, the venues don't hold big crowds. And even if you put a small fee on them, where money can maybe go back into fishing? No. no, too hard.
That's we had enough going on. One coming up, and there's a cod one coming up.
There is, and we had him on last week, but as they get closer, we're going to do that. Michael Condratui, fisheries told me at Portland on the weekend that gemfish aren't to be taken anymore. They must be thrown back. I said they come up dead from that depth. He said you're still not allowed to take them, as there's not many around. Other stupid rules by the government. Could you find out, please? And if true, need to talk about this on your show, as it's not listed on the fisheries booklet, and the last thing we would want is people to be fined. Haven't heard of that.
If it's not listed in the Fisheries Victoria booklet, does that not automatically mean it's a bag limit of 5?
I've got no idea. Gemfish. I've got no idea, but he's saying that fisheries have told him. Maybe let's put it to the test. Yeah. If someone knows at home that knows us, send us a text message. Are you allowed to take gemfish or not? Love to know the answer to that.
Yeah, that's an interesting one. I'll do the research.
And we might just get an answer for Michael by the end of the show, if you could. Anyone at home that knows, or put on our Facebook page, if you like. Are you allowed or aren't you allowed to take gemfish in Victorian waters? There you go. If you'd like to write to me or these blokes, this is what you have to do.
Send your mail to Kramer's Mailbag, P.O. Box 734, Paterson Lakes, Victoria 3197, or email kramer@ifish.com.au.
And boys, I mentioned the Port Phillip Bay conference was on last Friday night. Gee, it was good. Great info.
I'd shattered. I couldn't make that. I was ready to go. It just didn't happen.
You know, 5:30 on a Friday. So, and there was a few stragglers coming in and that. But, there was good, close to 200 people there, and plenty of people that watched the show as well. So plenty of good feedback about talking fishing, which was good.
Yeah, so Dave, just quickly give us the quick rundown, because this wasn't a political thing. This was just what is happening in Port Phillip Bay.
It was more about the bay. So we had presentations from Dallas De Silva from VR Fish about how many people are fishing the bay. I talked a little bit about the future and the Future Fish Foundation's vision for Port Phillip Bay. We had presentations from Corey Green, who's doing all the calamari science and also about to do yellowtail kingfish science, which is going to be crucial to that fishery, just learning a little bit about them. Then we had Paul Hamer, who's snapper scientist, and Paul's also running the artificial reefs program for Port Phillip Bay, and they're doing some really big work on restoring natural reefs in the bay. So there's a few areas around the bay where they're actually planting, well, they're actually recycling shells, would you believe? So they're getting all these shells and breaking it all up and actually putting that on, and I'm talking hundreds of tons of shells on the seabed. Then they're planting oysters, live oysters, which are a native to Port Phillip Bay. Yep. So they're doing all this work to restore natural reefs. So that was unbelievable. Sheree Maris, who was a former Young Australian of the Year and a real champion of underwater and, you know, just the environment, and she gave us some great footage of fish and stuff that you go, you know, it's a bit like the Barrier Reef, but that is Port Phillip Bay, so we heard that. Rex Hunt gave a very good talk about how he's seen the bay over, you know, decades of experience fishing in Port Phillip Bay. So, and then we all formed a big panel with Travis Dowling and Craig Ingram at the end and answered people's questions for over an hour.
Wow.
It was pretty good.
That's awesome.
What about the netting? I mean, we're moving forward out of a netting era into a non-netting era. I mean, that's going to have a lot of effect, and that's going to be measured in some way. They're going to measure that in some way as far as those smaller depths with the dragging of nets and things.
Good question. Mm. And I think time will tell how that is measured. Yeah. I think, you know, for a long time, fisheries have been measured by how much the commercial take is. Now, that's going to have to transfer over to the recreational take. And I know there's an angler diary program, but there's a whole lot of things going on at the moment to better prepare us for in the future about measuring how good fishing is and how many perhaps tons are coming out on different species and things like that. So that's all part of the future plan. Yeah. You know, there's a few years to go yet before all the netters are out.
Was there any part of the future plan to get rid of Pokemon off Altona Pier?
I think so. And I think they're talking about getting the poachers from South Africa to come along with their SK-70s or something. Yeah. What are they?
You get rid of the Pokemon.
Blast the Pokemon. What sort of guns do they have again?
AK-47s.
SK-70s, same thing. So they need a few more of them to focus on Pokemon players, I tell you what. Coming up, this week's Hot Spots, and we discuss the opening of trout season in Victoria next on Talking Fishing.
Talking Fishing.
G'day, Callan here from Paul Worsland's Tackle World Cranbourne.
Supercharged batteries have been supplying maintenance-free marine batteries since 2001. The Seamaster Gold Range is second to none, delivering superior starting power and reserve capacity. No need to top up with water, truly a fit and forget battery. With up to 2 years replacement warranty, you know you have quality. Your battery is your lifeline. Without it, you're dead in the water because it's bloody hard to push start.
I've got a Seamaster battery in my boat.
Make yours a Seamaster Gold today.
Talking fishing, talking fishing, nothing but fishing, we're talking fishing.
And now the segment you've all been waiting for, Fishing Hotspots. Get on them, it's where the fish are.
Now, it mightn't be great weather on Friday and Saturday, but plenty of other days in the next 7 days are going to be fantastic for fishing. And if you want to stick to some land-based fishing, there is no better place right now than the Frankston Pier. I've seen photos of the garfish coming off Frankston Pier.
Finally!
They are sensational. Good size, 35, 40 centimetres, some real big ones amongst them, big and fat bodies as they are in winter. And it's the and I know the people don't like us, but do us a favour. If you see any Pokemon players, just
accidentally shove them in. I've heard Pokemon players make great garfish burly.
Who sets where the Pokemons are?
No idea.
No, we shouldn't be talking about it, I tell you.
Another Pokemon.
Another place right on the opposite side of Port Phillip Bay is Clifton Springs. And over in Clifton Springs, Trolley, in your neck of the woods at Tackle World Geelong, some lovely calamari over that side of the bay.
Yeah, they have been getting some nice calamari, some big ones too. So, some excellent fish.
It's that time of year. Heading over into Western Port, the Warneat Channel is fishing very, very well for King George Whiting at the moment. Always best on close to a high tide, either side of that high tide. There's plenty of water covering the banks. And a bit of pippy, if you want to get there early on the low tide, pump some bass yabbies. There's plenty of bass yabbies in that Warneat Channel there and just near the boat ramp. And seriously, even blowing a gale in northerly winds, you can hide in that channel. Completely out of the wind and just a great place for some King George whiting this time of year.
And make the most of it too, because it's always hard trying to find whiting in winter, but they've been getting up there in those shallows when those nice warm days we're starting to get now. Make the most of that.
We're talking 11, just 11, getting onto 12 degrees in the bay proper, you get up into some of those channels where it's, you know, 13,
that's right,
13 and a half. So it makes a lot of difference.
It does.
Just that little bit of warmth. So San Remo is another place where there's some beautiful King George whiting at the moment too, boys. You know, nice fresh ocean water there, and the King George are just loving it at the moment down that neck of the woods.
I reckon San Remo probably doesn't get spoken enough about. And maybe the highly tidal water puts a few people off, but it's whiting heaven down there.
Yep, just fish a little bit heavier, and there's just some fantastic fishing. Now, we've spoken about it a number of times, Lake Eildon. It is the place to go right now. Get up over the Great Divide, get out of the yucky weather that Melbourne's going to have, and Murray Cod and Trelly, just trolling lures. Is that
just
the best
trolling
way?
Lures, like Ed said to you, earlier on, some big bib lures. Don't be scared to use a really big lure.
Yeah?
Yeah, about this long.
Yeah.
So big bibs and get them down deep. And we're just mentioning the weather. The weather's this time of year, I find it's great. You don't get the wind so much. You get the storms, but you don't get the wind so much in those really nice days.
And just amongst the trees.
Amongst your trees. Look for your points. Like look for your rocky points, so you can actually crisscross your rocky points.
Yeah.
Eildon, I think, sort of around about sort of getting close to 60% now. So it's raised a bit.
It's come up a fair bit, hasn't it?
And there's a lot of guys. If you're going to go up there and chase cod, there's a lot of guys up there chasing yellowbell at the moment.
Yeah.
Just baits. And just drift them across the weed. As the water's coming up over the weed, they're chasing the yellow belly up there and fishing some nice yellow belly.
And we haven't seen many yellow belly, but the ones we've seen have been massive.
Crackers.
Massive.
Mm. Mm. Paul said, just back on the Murray Cod in Lake Eildon, Paul was in 6 metres of water, and he had two other fish on that he lost, but he said they were crackers.
Wow.
So there's certainly some fish, and he's saying no more than 6 metres, stay in that, around the timber, but 6 metres of water, no deeper. And get your lures right down and
it'll just
and
get better.
Unreal.
That's good, isn't it? Lucky last hot spot of the week is another little trout lake that you can get to. Take the family, take the barbecue. Emerald Park Lake.
That's a nice spot up there.
If you want to catch Puffing Billy up or do whatever, get up there, because all those little lakes have all been stocked with trout, and you know, it's a great little place for the family, like
great
I said,
day,
and take the kids fishing. Same method as what we're talking about at Casey Fields.
Exactly.
So a bit of corn or a bit of power bait or anything like that under a float, that'll do you.
Yeah, why not?
Yeah, exactly. So, all good.
Boys,
a couple of other things coming up. Like we said, the 4x4 show this weekend, but in 2 weekends' time after that, first weekend of September, it's trout opening.
That time already?
Already.
I know.
It's gone quick.
It's flying. Yes.
Weather's getting warmer.
Yeah.
Lovely.
So, you know, it is a great time of year when it's the smell of spring when the trout opens. It's a smell of spring. And there's a couple of things that Fisheries Victoria is doing this year. Firstly, they're going to hold a event at Ballarat, and it's the Ballarat Fishing Festival for 2016. It's a free event. Come and celebrate the opening of trout season in rivers and the great freshwater fishing opportunities around Ballarat, particularly Windaree, based at Lake Windaree opposite Loreto College. There'll be free activities for the whole family. That's on Saturday, the 3rd of September, 9 a.m. to 3 p.m. So just make an excuse, go along to Ballarat and enjoy it if you're from the western side of town.
Yep.
Free food for the fish.
Yeah. If you're on the northern side of town or the eastern side of town, you want to go somewhere different, head up to Eildon for the Goulburn Fishing Festival. Come and celebrate the opening of trout season in rivers and the great freshwater fishing opportunities around Eildon. Based at the Eildon Community Centre, there will be free activities for the whole family. Again, Saturday, 3rd of September, 10 a.m. to 4 p.m. Now, there is fireworks, there's fishing demonstrations on Eildon Pondage, and it's once a year activity where Snobs Creek Hatchery is actually open for the public.
Yeah, make the most of these events, because fisheries are having a red hot crack at turning I guess, the opening of our seasons into a legitimate event. It's not just a little come down, have a look at Eildon, it's all good. These are legitimate events. There's kids' activities.
Yep.
The hatchery itself is a reason to go.
Yeah.
A great place and a great initiative by Fisheries Victoria to put this out there so people can understand what's going on this time of year.
Yeah, it's been going a few years now, but it's getting bigger now.
And it is.
Power bait on the floats, bit of a secret, go up there to Pondage.
Yeah.
Good work.
No, exactly. Trolly, let's head back to Africa again now. So do you need licences to shoot or can you shoot on public land? You know, what's some of the rules and regulations? Depends how big your machine gun is.
Very regulated over there as far as your firearms and we had to have proper documentation and all that type of thing, registration for our guns. And a lot of the places have actually got fences that are like 10, 12 feet tall. And it's amazing how many places over there are actually part ranch or part farm, part conservation. Lots and lots and lots of conservation reserves.
Okay.
You're
saying that they're fenced in, there's big fences. So does that stop the animals getting out, does it? So
well, it stops animals getting out, but some of these might be 25,000 acres as a small one, and some of them are absolutely huge, like they're thousands of square acres, like literally 200,000 square acres.
So when you put the fence up, are the animals inside then yours, or are they animals put in there?
What they do is they actually keep control of the numbers. So it's a bit like having fish in a pond, and you can only got so much food. I mean, if there's more fish in the pond that can sustain the food, obviously the fish are going to die. So sometimes they'll introduce hunting as a form of control of animals.
Okay.
If they've got too many...
So too many white rhinoceroses.
Yeah. Let's pick on white rhinoceroses, right? So if you've got a landscape that'll sustain 100 vegetating eating animals, and you've got 150 of them in there, they'll eventually eat themselves out and die.
So like giraffes, you'd have to go and shoot.
Exactly. So the idea of...
You really want to shoot something big game, don't you?
I'm not trying to get Charlie in trouble at all.
It's a control. So under that method, they charge huge amounts of money for people to come on and shoot, and that money then goes back into sustaining what's already there.
Okay. Now, so is there anything controversial to shoot? I mean, you see these photos on Facebook of the dentist who's just killed Larry the Lion.
And it's funny you mentioned the giraffe. That's another one that's popped up on social media.
Yeah, look, I have no, in my lifetime, I have no incentive to shoot anything like that.
No.
So, but money speaks a lot of languages.
Really? Yeah. So it still goes on?
Yes,
not real good.
Under sustainable practices.
Yep.
Got to remember that.
It's amazing to hear that, I guess, from someone who's just been, because you do read about it on Facebook, wonder whether it's legal, illegal, can you still do it on private property and all that sort of stuff. So good information. I'm sure you've got a few more tales to tell. We might try and catch up in the next couple of weeks. That's it for Talking Fishing. We hope you enjoyed the show. For those of you attending this week's 4x4 and Fishing Expo at the Melbourne Showgrounds, make sure you come and say hello. Adam and I will be on the Tackle World stand the entire 3 days. I think it's going to hail this Friday and Saturday in Melbourne. Don't let that stop you from coming along. It's a lot of indoor activities. Until we see you again on Talking Fishing next week, please stay safe on the water and enjoy your fishing.
Talking fishing, nothing but fishing, we're talking fishing. We got all you need, just take a look. Watch those fish jump on your hook. So just relax and take your time. Enjoy the show, then drop us a line. Talking fishing, nothing but fishing, we're talking fishing. Talking fishing, nothing but fishing, we're talking fishing. Talking. Talking fishing, nothing but fishing, talking fishing. If it's facts about fishing that you want to know, then tune in, folks, because this is the show. We'll show you all the right bait to use, so sit right back, you got nothing to lose. Doesn't really matter if it's trout or carp, flathead, marlin, or a gummy shark. Listen to the guys and you can't go wrong. They'll be talking about fishing till the cows come home. Talking fishing, nothing but fishing, we're talking fishing.
Welcome everyone to Talking Fishing, a big show coming your way tonight, including pictures of a metre plus Murray cod coming out of Lake Eildon last weekend. Quite a commotion on Altona Pier. We take a look at what caused that. A fish thief got caught stuffing calamari down his waders. What an idiot. And we're joined by the event director of this weekend's 4x4 and Fishing Expo at the Melbourne Showgrounds. All that and more, let's get into it with a big welcome to the man who travels by kayak, Adam Ring. Welcome, Ads.
Thanks, Dave. It's time to dust off the kayak, finally. It's been a few nice weekends have rolled on and off we go.
Did I mention it's going to hail this weekend?
starting the weekend.
It doesn't matter because you are taking your kayak to the 4x4 show this weekend. In fact, you're going to take the whole collection and everyone will be able to see the kayaks.
Come and have a look.
We're going to talk about kayak fishing because it's a growing sport, isn't it?
It is. It is. It's a great way to get around.
It's a big welcome back to the man who made it out of Africa alive. His first show back from a winter break all the way from Shepparton. Welcome, Stephen Victor Trelly Trelfel.
Thanks for that, David.
No worries, Trelly. Anytime.
No worries.
You made it back, mate.
I did, actually. And some amazing things happened over there. And and some great stories to be told. But one of the biggest stories was the actual poaching that goes on over there.
Okay.
Now, we know poaching is poaching, but these guys are in gangs with AK-47s and things. So, yeah, it's a pretty sad story.
So what are they poaching?
A lot of rhinoceroses.
Yeah.
For their horn, their front horn.
Still?
Yeah, still.
In this day and age?
And close to town, like within kilometres of the main, like Johannesburg.
So what, there's big money in it or something, obviously,
huge
is there?
Money yeah. Huge money in it. So, yeah, that's one of the sad stories over there. But a lot of good stuff we got up to, too, on the train, which is great. Yeah. Thank you.
Okay, plenty of stories to be told tonight, I tell you what. And it's just a little sprinkling of spring almost, isn't there, in the air? You know, it's been fairly good weather, bit of warm weather even on the weekend. I know it was a little bit blowy, but Sunday was okay, and some nice fish caught too.
Yeah, it's been good because obviously it's been a long winter and a lot of people have stayed in hibernation, and I don't blame them. It has been cold and it's been wet, but all that seems to be a little bit behind us. It just felt... It felt different. 18 degrees doesn't sound warm, but you know that sun's got a little bit of bite, and it's so interesting to see the motivation that sort of runs through your body once there's a bit of warmth going on. So looking forward to summer.
Yeah. Spring is only around the corner now. Trelly, we asked you for a photo or two, and this is the only one you came up with. No, this is a serious photo now. My eyes are playing up on me a little bit tonight, but I can't work out what sort of animal that is. But when, so you put that on the roast, did this crackling go hard on that at all?
Well, never seen one rotisserised.
I am joking. We do not promote harming. That's a baby rhinoceros.
That is, yeah. Well, that was one of the byproducts of the poaching, that one. So that was actually in an area that's basically a rehabilitation for animals.
Okay.
And that little guy there, you noticed, actually had its horn cut off as well.
Yeah.
But it was cute. It was like, you could see it was only so big.
Yeah.
It'd come up to you and sort of like get along the fence and you could pat him and do all that sort of stuff. And, give him a poke. But, it's thick skin. They just like poking at the table. But,
really?
Yeah.
Now, Charlie, it wouldn't be the same if we didn't happen to come across a picture of you in your travels. Have a look what you got up to, Charlie. You always get caught out lying on the lounge after a few drinks, and you just got transported around South Africa like that. Is that right?
Well, I did actually, and I just wanted to keep the South African culture going.
Yeah.
Just being carted around there.
I tell you what.
From shooting stand to shooting stand.
Yeah, just having a little break in between shots. Yeah. But anyway, boys, let's have a look at what's been caught by the people at home. It's time for Catch of the Week.
Catch of the Week, brought to you by Shimano, providing reliable, trustworthy, quality fishing gear for your enjoyment.
Now, our first Catch of the Week gets an 11 out of 10 for effort, because Paul Delisle, he's been headed up to Eildon for quite some time now, and he's had many a session on a 60 and 70 centimetre fish, but have a look at that. Cracked the metre for the first time, 105 centimetres on a stump jumper in the Big River Arm. Thank you very much.
Nice fish. Look at that. It's a great... Look at it. Proportion of that fish is just perfect, isn't it?
It's perfect, isn't it? Yeah.
Really nice fish.
Paul was absolutely stoked. Released unharmed. He said it seriously was out of the water for about 10 seconds. I spoke to him today about it, and he just said, fish of a lifetime.
Yep.
He has certainly put in the hours. But, Trolley, we had Anthony Forster.